Good morning. Welcome to Good Shepherd. It's great to have you all here with us as we gather together in the name of our Savior Jesus. And that gathering together, that community, the communion that's ours because we come together in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that's a special thing. That's a special thing that the scriptures talk about as what connects us first to Christ. As the Bible describes, he's our head. He's the head of the body, the church. And then connects us to each other as a witness to our world. And so we're going to be exploring that theme. Usually as a congregation, we have a yearly theme. This year is a little different. Pastor Whirling would normally have a yearly theme at the beginning of the year. Today we're going to talk about our theme for the next couple months. And of course, we have Pastor Harmon here. And Pastor Harmon's preparing us, helping us discern what's next for us as a congregation. And as we do that as a people formed by Christ, a people gathered by Christ. And the people around you are important. So our theme today is Community of Christ. And this is a theme we're going to actually explore with our leadership council and look at ways we can encourage the community here formed by Christ and make plans as we transition to a new year, new calendar year, as far as our leadership is concerned, and look at the people around us as important. God calls us not just as individuals, but he calls us into a church, his body, his house. And we'll look and explore that theme in our sermon and what the good news of Jesus Christ, his death and his resurrection, mean for that. Things in your bulletin, things to take note of. Youth group is doing a bunch of events next week. They're going putt-putting. Outreach committee has music bingo night scheduled for April 24th. Primetimers are getting together. Other things, including VBS, is there. And then if you have if you're a youth group, a high school youth group, or I think there's some even for eighth grade and high school youth, there's information about a camp and going out to a special needs camp in Schuyler, Nebraska, Camp Luther there, June 6th to 9th. And encourage you to look at that and also National Youth Gathering this morning. With that, Pastor Harmon's going to lead us in worship.
Please rise. We begin our service, as Pastor said, during this Easter season with what it's really all about. He is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. With that in mind, we begin in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Sing to the Lord a new song.
Sing to the Lord, all the earth.
Sing to the Lord, praise his name. Proclaim his salvation day after day.
Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all people.
For great is the Lord, and most worthy of praise.
Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and glory are in his sanctuary.
Ascribe to the Lord, O family of nations. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Let the heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad.
Let the sea resound and all that is in it.
Let the fields be jubilant and everything in them.
Sing to the Lord.
Sing to the Lord, all the earth.
Let's do just that. Please be seated. This joyful Eastertide, verses 1 through 3.
Thank you.
Please rise. Eternal God, our only source of life, of peace, of hope, we come to you today and seek your help where we have turned hard-hearted and lived away from you.
Forgive us, Lord, and turn us toward you.
Where we have wounded others in thoughtless and callous ways.
Forgive us, Lord, and change our ways.
Where we are worn out and tired from the burdens of life. Where we have lost the way and see no good future.
Fill us with the Lord, and guide us along the path of everlasting life.
Let us confess the root of our weakness and guilt.
Father, I confess that I have sinned and fallen short of your will and way for my life.
Have mercy on me, Lord, and renew me in your forgiveness and strength. Together, we confessed our sins. Together we share the burdens we carry. Together we need God. Our eternal God has not forgotten us, nor will he ever reject us. Out of his eternal love, he entered our broken world through his Son Jesus, so that he might make us his very own children. Through his sacrifice on the cross, through his resurrected and glorious body, he calls you to himself. He gives forgiveness for sins, strength and purpose to life each day, and assurance of his gracious presence and love, and the sure and certain hope of a glorious eternity. This is the God who loves you. Truly, he is our refuge and our strength. Trust him. Live for him. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
We join in the prayer of the day. Holy and righteous God, you are the author of life, and you adopt us to be your children. Fill us with your words of life, that we may live as witnesses to the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated as our Father welcomes us. We're called upon by God to remember our baptism altogether. What's the word? That's what I thought. It's daily. Remember our baptism every single day. That baptism reminds us of who we are in Him. To do that, would you rise and join with me? This is the Apostles' Creed. This is who we are baptized into whose name? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. He reminds us of how that works as Sarah reads our lessons for today.
The first reading is from Acts chapter 3. While he clung to Peter and John, all the people, utterly astounded, ran together to them in the portico called Solomon's. And when Peter saw it, he addressed the people, "Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this, or why do you stare at us, as though by our own power or piety we have made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate when he had decided to release him. But you denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked for a murderer to be granted to you, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses, and his name, by faith in his name, has made this man strong whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given the man this perfect health in the presence of you all. And now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. But what God foretold by the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer, he thus fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and turn back, that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send the Christ, appointed for you, Jesus, whom heaven must receive until the time for restoring all the things about which God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets long ago. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The second reading is from 1 John chapter 3. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be, he has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. Everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he appeared in order to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Whoever practices righteousness is righteous as he is righteous. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 24th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
As they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace to you." But they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet. That is I myself. Touch me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, he said to them, "Have you anything to eat here?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate before them. Then he said to them, These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated for the next hymn.
Let us pray. Dear gracious Father, we are thankful that you have brought us into your people, the church, and that through your Son, Jesus Christ, we have union with you and with another. And Lord, help us as we, as your people, follow you, trust you in a world where our own sin and the sin around us affects and infects us. And Lord, unite us in your Son, in his work of his Spirit, which brings people to you and leads us through difficult circumstances, leads us through trials, difficulties, and leads us through the power of your death and resurrection for us. Guide and lead us by your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our theme this year, at least for the next couple months, is, again, as I said before, community of Christ. And this is a message of of the Bible. It's throughout the Bible that we are not just saved as individuals, we're saved by Christ into a community. Verse that I highlighted, which maybe kind of summarizes this, is 1 Corinthians 1:9. It says, God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. God is faithful. God has been faithful, as we'll look at in just a little bit, ever since he formed Adam out of the ground. Ever since Adam and Eve fell into sin. And he continues to be faithful, even as people turn from him, rebel against him. And he's faithful to deliver us. Paul uses that word in that passage, fellowship, not just to talk about a gathering like we might talk about getting together for a fellowship, a time of having fun, but he uses that word to talk about the unity, the community, the communion that's formed by Jesus Christ. And so he wrote it to this Corinthian church 2,000 years ago because he wanted them to see that the unity they had in Jesus Christ as they felt face all kinds of struggles and problems. And if you read the book of 1 Corinthians, it's filled with one after another of things that could just tear this church apart. But he reminds them of their fellowship, their community, their communion with Christ through his death and resurrection. And we all have this need, right? We all have this need for community, to belong. We all need family. We need friends. And the Bible points us that this need for belonging, first of all, is our belonging to be in relationship with God. To be part of his family. To, as we heard and Pastor Harmon talked about, that need to see that we are baptized in his name. And to remember our baptism, that he has brought us into his people. And it's important we see and frame the idea of community based on how the Bible describes it, because there's all kinds of ways communities talk about our world, and there's all kinds of ways community can go wrong. Thinks of words maybe for communities that are twisted, turned, directed in a dangerous way. You can think of cliques, of gangs, of cults, of families that are highly dysfunctional. We need community, but we can, it doesn't have to look too hard to see all the ways communities can be torn apart, ways that there can be selfishness, disorder, and struggle in communities. And so this need for community, this need to have a relationship with God and other people, it's foundational, right? In fact, before Adam even fell into sin, when he had made Adam, he said, it's not good for man to be alone. It's not good for... And so what does he do? He made Eve, and he unites them in this relationship. This unites them in marriage, in this foundational relationship. And this closeness is, in a lot of ways, a pattern of the closeness that God that we are to have with God, and this closeness of this relationship, which forms children and families. And then Adam and Eve fall into sin, and you can see all the ways, all the fractures that start to develop when sinful people go their own way, want to live life on their own terms, want to neglect God. Adam and Eve's first children, Cain, murders Abel. And so sin and murder and jealousy and anger and killing enter the world. And then there, by the time of Noah, it says, every thought of man's heart was evil all the time. The world was filled with violence and God needed to start over. And throughout the Bible, there's a need, seen as a need to restore that community, restore that communion between God and the people he made. And have that affect the community of people that we see if sin is left to its own devices, just tears and destroys people. And so God started over. He started over with one man named Abraham and made a family out of his family. And despite the rebellion, God continued to save and work through them. Led them out of the nation of Egypt, formed them as a people, led them through the desert, and he gave them commandments. 10 commandments, which we'll look at and say, this is how you're to live. This is how you're to live with God and with each other. The first three, you focus on the relationship with God. We're to trust, have no other gods before him. And then the next 7 are all about people. And I think that's the right way to look at what God gives us in his commandments, his laws. God, and Jesus describes them this way, God's commandments are all about how we're to love God and love each other. They give us boundaries how not to treat the people around us. Don't kill. And Jesus interprets that as don't be angry at your brother. Don't commit adultery. Don't steal. Don't bear a false witness. Don't tear down the reputation of your neighbor. Don't covet the things of the people around you. He gives us these commandments to teach us how to love, how to treat people. And the scriptures, they delve deeper into that, what it means to love the people around us. And so God, he forms a people for himself. He gives us instructions about how we're to treat people, boundaries, wisdom regarding how to live in relationship with others. I was a couple weeks ago, Palm Sunday, I was, Pastor Harmon led the service, and I was off in Fort Wayne going and watching a tournament for my son, a basketball tournament there. We're there, and I kind of knew that this message was coming up and this theme, and kind of had my ears perked, and I heard in the restaurant there somebody talking about their fellowship. Talking about their fellowship, and that's kind of an interesting thing. Well, you're talking about the people and the community that they were gathered together with, and as you drove around the next day, found that there was a convention going on across the way from where our hotel was, and actually saw on this little billboard outside the convention center a welcome to a Bible study. But it wasn't actually a Christian group that was there, and it wasn't a Christian group that was there in fellowship. I found out later this was a group of Jehovah's Witness. Jehovah's Witnesses gathered together here for a convention. And you look at what Jehovah's Witnesses are. In fact, we went to out for pizza one night, and actually there were probably 30 people from that convention and us in this pizza place. So we were basically surrounded by their community. And you look at what Jehovah's Witnesses believe. They are people that gather together for community, but it's a different type of community, right? They are people actually who believe, look to the Bible and say, we look here for wisdom. But they believe different things about the Savior, Jesus. They don't believe Jesus actually physically rose from the dead. They don't believe in the Trinity, these basic foundational beliefs that we just announce, confess to each other in the words of the Apostles' Creed. And I think the scriptures will show that if the community is not founded on the God who forms it, it's going to be a different type of community. We all have a need to belong and accepted, and I think those members there, the Jehovah's Witnesses, are there because they have a need to belong to something and be accepted. A lot of them had, I think, shirts that kind of talked about their struggles with alcohol and drug addiction. And I think that in there they found a community of people that they could go and be accepted by. But only Jesus Christ and his death and resurrection is the one that can forgive us. He can give us everlasting life. He can give us hope, just not in this world, but in the life to come. So what makes a Christian community, a community founded on Jesus, and his death and resurrection, his work for us, what makes it unique? Well, the way the Bible talks about that is that Jesus is the head of a body. That's one image it gives us. Jesus is this head of this body. And so he, as we sang in our hymn, also so forms it. And all of us are members in this body. We're connected with each other. We're brought in through him. We're connected through him. And the body doesn't consist of one member, but many. And if you look at what the Bible has to say about that, 1 Corinthians has to say about that, it says the people in the body to look to the people around them and look at the different gifts and not to consider one more important than the other. Baptism is what we're brought into the body. And so baptism is this great equalizer that unites us and gives us the Holy Spirit. And he is the head. He is the one who directs us. He's also the chief cornerstone, the one that everything is built on. And he makes us living, as 1 Peter describes, living stones, part of this holy house of people gathered together in his name. We are a people created by God, created by Christ. And his mercy and grace cause us to be different types of people. Not that we are people who have it all together, people who don't still struggle with sin, but we're people who know the one who made us, the one who saved us, the one who redeems us, the one who gives us life. As I was preparing this, I also was thinking about a popular movie about 25 years ago called The Matrix. And in fact, when I was first doing youth ministry, a lot of people would use this movie, and there's some Christian themes, kind of like Jehovah's Witness has some Christian-like things in there in their belief in the Bible, but don't quite get things right and distort things. But in this movie, there's some Christian themes in it, a battling evil through sacrifice, about not being, you know, not following the distortions you see in this world. But in this movie, a lot of you may have seen it, some of you have not. There's a problem in how it views what it means to be human. The chief hero in the story, Neo, he learns and he battles things. He downloads skills. There's a comment there that he downloaded this information. They learn kung fu, and behind, as you look at the film directors and what they were trying to communicate in this movie, they were caught up in this teaching. It's not necessarily a new teaching. It's called Christian Gnosticism. Which isn't really Christian. You could kind of take out the Christian word for this. This idea that the body is bad and what's needed is just to free our mind and to escape this life. And in fact, the early Gnostics, the people who lived 1,800 years ago, they would turn Christianity, take some truths of Christian teaching, and they'd lead them in a different way, and kind of just turn Christianity into a teaching of opening up your mind and getting rid of your body, your dependence on your body and the people around you, and just kind of escaping to this higher spiritual existence. But that's not the message of Christianity. The message of Christianity is not that our bodies are bad, but rather that our bodies and souls have been corrupted by sin and they need to be redeemed and restored. And that we all will die, but Jesus rose from the dead. He died for us and he rose from the dead. And we can see this in our reading today, our gospel reading from Luke. It says that Jesus shows Jesus eating with his disciples and revealing himself as bodily risen, not just the spiritual person, but there with them in his body. There with them in his body. And then it says he opens up their minds, but he opens them up to the scriptures. He opens them up to the Bible, his word for them. And then he points them to their mission, to be a witness for him. He opens up to see him, to see how he rose from the dead, how he gives us life, to see his word, the Bible, and how it frees us, forgives us, gives us life eternal. And then he calls him to be a witness. Jesus rose for you. He died for you. And he physically rose in his body. And I think that changes how we view the people around us. The people around us aren't just people to be used, manipulated. They're people that Jesus died and rose for. And we're to care about the people and their bodies and souls. We're to care about their needs in this world, but ultimately about their salvation in Christ. Because he died and rose for them. And the way the Bible describes Jesus' resurrection is this is the first fruits. Because Jesus rose from the dead, those who are in Christ will also rise to life everlasting. And so we, as a people who've been gathered together in the name of Jesus, in the name of the one who died and rose for us, we are called by the Bible a new creation. A new creation. Again, that's not that we don't still struggle with sin. The Bible describes that your problems are not gone just because you're a Christian. But Jesus died for you. He rose for you, and his Spirit lives in you. His Holy Spirit has called you to faith. And calls you to love the people around you, to care about them, to not just look as the people around you as not important, as just people to get through, but to look at each and every one of the people in your families, in your communities, and especially in your church, as people that Jesus died and rose for, and that people that you are connected to. Especially the church. The Bible describes us as a people, as a body, as a house. People called and gathered together in the name of Jesus. So know this. Jesus died for you. Jesus rose for you. And in him, you are a new creation. Called to love the people around you. Called to love them in the freedom of the grace and mercy he has shown you. Live in that freedom and that hope that is yours in your Savior Jesus. Now may the peace that surpasses all understanding guard our hearts and minds in faith in Christ Jesus our Lord. I invite you to rise as Pastor Harmon leads us in prayer.
In our prayers today, we continue to lift up Cody McAlpin, Chuck Ulner, Ron Baran, Shirley Kiesling, Ron Johns, Heinz Olk. And I ask you to join with my wife and I, Arlita. Tomorrow, later today, we drive back to Kansas City for her sister's funeral, which is tomorrow. Would you join with me as we pray? Great Almighty Father, for the wonder of your creation, for the faithfulness of your daily care for us, for the constant reminders of your love, we lift up our hearts to you.
Praise you, Father.
Lord Jesus, for your bitter sufferings and death, for your glorious resurrection, and for the grace which you have shown us, by which we have received everlasting life, we lift up our hearts to you.
Praise you, Lord Jesus.
Holy Spirit, our great comforter, for the gift of faith by which we know our Redeemer and we grow in his grace and knowledge by word and sacrament, we lift up our hearts to you.
Praise to you, O Holy Spirit.
God of grace and glory, we thank you for the wonderful news of Christ's resurrection victory. Jesus has defeated all the enemies that lurk in this dark world, sin, death, and the devil. Keep our eyes of faith fixed upon Jesus. Keep our hearts longing for that day when heaven and earth will be united. Gracious God, dear Lord Jesus, when you walked upon this earth, you healed the sick, gave sight to the blind, caused the lame to walk, and you raised the dead. We pray for all who suffer in body and spirit today. You know and understand pain, fears, sorrow. Bring relief, grant peace. Reassure each one that you are a present help in this time of need. Merciful Lord, come to the aid of your people. Lord of the Church, we pray your blessing upon the mission that you have given to each of us personally, the mission of our congregation, the mission of your church throughout the world. Help us all to not be ashamed of the gospel, but to joyfully live in it and share it. These and all of the prayers upon our hearts today, we bring to you in the confident assurance that out of your love, you hear and answer our prayers, and you're willing to bring us to your eternal peace and joy, ultimately in heaven. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Please be seated as we collect our offerings. We rise and join together in the prayer our Lord has given to us. Together we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on that very night in which he was betrayed, took bread. He broke it, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body. It's given for you for the remission, forgiveness of all of your sin. Do this often as you remember me." He then took the cup, he blessed it, he gave thanks, he gave it to them. And he said, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood. It is shed for you for the remission of all of your sin. This too, do often as you remember me." Welcome to the table of the Lord. Please be seated. Thank you. Please rise as we go forth with his blessings. Brothers and sisters, go in peace, and the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you always.
Amen. Amen.